Okay, let us move to next few questions. This one, this is an interesting question. So let us try to solve this. Take some time, no hurries. Whatever you do, do it properly and try to get somewhere. This is question number 11. Just one hint I want to give. If you displace the lens vertically, horizontal distance will not change. Okay, so let me solve now. Now, the first image. Here we have focal length F1 for the first one and focal length F2 for the second one. Okay, small d is less than both F1 and F2. Okay, so we have the parallel beam of rays coming from the left hand side. So where it will coincide or where the image will try to get formed? Image will be getting formed at the focal length, right? So somewhere at a distance of F1, let us say, this is where the image is getting formed. So this distance should be equal to F1. Right? So, but then there is a second lens. Okay, because there is a second lens, actual image will not get formed there. This image, which is the image of the first lens, will behave as an object of the second lens. Okay, so in order to find the final image distance, I need to use the lens formula for the second lens. So 1 by v minus 1 by u is equal to 1 by f2. Okay, now v represents the final image. Okay, minus what is u? U is this distance because I am applying lens formula for the second lens, right? And that distance will be equal to f1 minus d. Okay, because f1 is a positive quantity, focal length of a convex lens. This is equal to 1 by f2. Fine. So I will get V to be equal to F2 times F1 minus D divided by F1 plus F2 minus D. Okay. Now, this is the final image. So maybe final image gets formed over here somewhere, and this distance is given as this. Okay, but what is asked is the x coordinate. So x coordinate will be what? This, its distance from the second lens plus small d. That is the x coordinate, right? So x coordinate will be equal to v plus d. Okay, then you'll see that x coordinate will come out to be this. Okay, which is in the option third and fourth. Both have x coordinates. Okay, so 1 and 2, they are out of question now. So it is between 3 and 4. All right. Now you can play smart here a little bit and say that anyways, since the lens is displaced vertically, so vertical displacement of the image will happen. Y coordinate will not remain zero. So you can mark option 3 and move ahead. Okay. So that is like playing smart here and not taking some risk and moving ahead. But then if you actually want to find the answer here, then you can find out like this. First of all, you have to understand that principal axis for the second lens is here somewhere, okay? And object of the second lens is on the principal axis of the first lens because image of the first lens is the object of second. So this is the object for the second lens. Fine. Now this object, I can treat it like an extended object for the second lens. Okay. Because what is the object's height? Object's height is its distance vertically from the principal axis. Okay, so I can just track where this tip of the object goes after the refraction from the second lens, and that is where the image will be. Okay, so magnification of the second lens is basically V by U. Okay, now V is this, and U is what? U is F1 minus D. So V by U becomes F2 divided by F1 plus F2 minus D. This is the magnification. Okay, this magnification should be equal to size of the image divided by delta, which is the size of the object. So height becomes equal to F2 delta divided by F1 plus F2 minus D. Okay, now this is the height from the principal axis of the second lens. Okay, but y coordinate is what? Y coordinate is distance from the first principal axis, because first principal axis, that is the principal axis of the first lens, is the x coordinate. Sorry, is the y coordinate. All right, so sorry for that. This is the height from the second principal axis. So distance from the first principal axis will be h minus delta, because delta is a distance between two principal axes. Okay, and that's how you get this as the correct option, option number three. Fine, so slightly difficult question. So if this kind of question comes in JEE mains, I know, I hope what you have to do, you know, you have to leave this type of questions. It will just eat up your time. Okay, so this question, if something like this comes, it has to be from JEE Advanced. Okay. All right, so let us take up other questions. So the 12th question is a single slit experiment, okay? And the distance between the first minima on either side is nothing but the width of the central maxima. And width of the central maxima, I hope you remember, is lambda d by 2 lambda d by a, okay? So this will be written as 2 into lambda, which is 6 into 10 to the power minus 7. Capital D is 2 divided by A. Now A is 10 to the power minus 3. Okay, so you will get 2.4 mm. So question number 12, option 4 is correct. Why are you saying 2? Oh, guys, be careful, okay? Distance between the first minima on the either side, it is saying, okay? The distance of the first minima is lambda d by a. Distance between two minimas on either side is 2 lambda d by a. Okay, others, what are you getting? Question number 13. Purvik retracted his message. Purvik said they will remain parallel, and he said option one is correct. See, this ray, these two rays, they are hitting the first surface along the normal, right? So they'll just go straight and then hit the other surface. Fine. You want me to do this now? Anyone got the answer? No one. Okay, Naman is telling one answer. Others, Okay, let me solve now. What is this angle of incidence? This is 60 degrees. So this is also 60 degrees. So angle of incidence is 30 degrees. Okay, now it will bend away from the normal, right? So since prism is the denser medium, so it will bend like this. Okay, it goes like that. So this angle is, let us say, R. Okay, this is I. So I can say that 1.44 sine of I is equal to 1 into sine of R. Okay, so sine of R is equal to sine of I is what? Sine of I is sine of 30, which is half. Okay, so this is 0.72. All right, so R becomes equal to sine inverse 0.72. Okay, now the option is with respect to what angles these rays are making. Okay, so if I get to know what is this angle, then double of this angle will be the answer, yes or no? Because other ray will also come like this, same angle the other ray will also make. Okay, so double of this angle will be the answer. Now how much is this angle? If I know I and if I know R, what is that angle equal to be? If I extend this line like this, what I'll get here is that this angle is this angle. Getting it? Now, this angle is nothing but R minus I. Okay, because total angle is R. Okay, and this angle is I. So this angle will become R minus I. Okay, so 2 times of R minus I is the angle between the two rays. So that will be equal to 2 times sine inverse of 0.72 minus 2 times, or let's keep 2 common, minus 30 degrees. Okay, so that is why option number 3 is correct over here. Fine. Any doubt on this question, guys? Type in yes or no quickly. I'll move to the next one. Okay, all of you got 14th. A diminished image of an object is to be obtained on a screen 1 meter from it. This can be achieved by placing convex lens of focal length less than 0.25 meter, concave lens. Now, first of all, this is getting formed on the screen, right? So since it is getting formed on the screen, it has to be a real object. Okay, so plane mirror creates a virtual object, sorry, virtual image. So since it is formed on a screen, it has to be real image. So plane mirror is not possible. Even convex mirror forms virtual image. Even this cannot be put on the screen, right? And then concave lens also will create a virtual image. So it has to be option 3 only. Okay, now let's talk about the 15th one. An eye specialist prescribes spectacles having combinations of convex lens of focal length 40 in contact with the concave, the power of the combination. So you can see that similar concept was tested in JEE earlier also. So simply you need to write down the combined power as 1 by F1 should be in meters plus 1 by F2. Now you have to take care of the signs also. It is a concave lens, so minus of 0.25 you have to write. Okay, so I think you'll get what, minus 1.5. Okay, this is equal to 4 and this is 10 by 4. Okay, so let's quickly move to the next few questions. So you might be seeing that majority of the questions are straightforward from this chapter, but sometimes questions get twisted. So there is a high chance that an easy question will come from this particular chapter. These two chapters. So make sure you do good amount of practice, because high chance that, if you do some practice, you will get the answer in the exam. Okay, this is not. Okay, all of you getting question 16th answer as pi, as in option number 3. It's a single slit experiment. Okay, let me solve question number 16. Those who have got 16 can move to question number 17. Parallel monochromatic beam of light incident on a narrow slit. So this is the narrow slit, it incident here. Diffraction pattern is formed here in this screen. Okay, at the first minimum of the diffraction pattern, the phase difference between the rays coming from the two edges of this slit is what? Now, first minima location, you should know. Suppose this is distance y. Okay, distance y should be equal to lambda d by a, where a is the width of the single slit. Okay, similar expression comes for the maxima in the double slit experiment, but for single slit experiment, this is what the case is. Okay, minima happens to be at a distance of lambda d by a. Okay, now we need to find the phase difference between the rays coming from the two edges of this slit. Okay, now let's connect these two rays. So one is this one and the other one is this. So we need to find the phase difference between these two. Okay, now we know the standard procedure of finding the phase difference, right? You drop a perpendicular on All right, so we are live. All right, so there is a standard way to find the phase difference or path difference. You just drop a perpendicular like this, and this is the path difference. This is delta x. Okay, now in order to find delta x, what we typically do is we connect this line like that. Okay, and then this is the angle theta, then even this angle is theta. So delta x is this distance, which is a, sine of theta. Okay, and if theta is very less, then delta x I can also approximate it as a tan of theta. Fine. So this is delta x. Now corresponding to this delta x, the phase difference is 2 pi by lambda into delta x. So 2 pi by lambda into delta x, which is 8 tan theta. Now tan theta is what? Y divided by this distance, which is d. Okay. Y is what? Lambda d by a divided by d, which is tan theta. Okay, now you see that lambda get cancelled, A get cancelled, and D get cancelled. Okay, so phase difference is 2 pi. Okay, so 16th option number 4 is correct. Many of you have said 3, right? Okay, so I guess you have tried question number 17 also. Let's see how we can go about it. Now, this kind of question where there is no definitive option, as in it doesn't talk about distance being 5.4 centimeter or 20 centimeter like that. It doesn't talk about a definitive statement, but it just tries to, you know, find out the estimate of it, where exactly it will be between which and which point. This can be done best by using ray diagram. Okay. Now let us see how we can utilize ray diagram to answer this question. We have concave mirror, which is placed on the horizontal table. This is the horizontal table. So we have a concave mirror like this. This is the concave mirror. And axis is vertically upwards. Okay, so this is the axis. O is the pole and C is the center of curvature. So let's say C is here. Okay, a point object is placed at C only. So there is an object here. Okay, so the image will be where right now? Image will be at C only, okay, because whatever ray that comes out of C will hit the mirror normally, so the ray will retrace its path. Okay, now we are filling the mirror with water. Let us say this is the water. Okay, so if I fill this with water, what will happen here is that the ray that was normal to the mirror, suppose this ray, if it keeps on going, then it will hit the mirror normally and the ray will just reflect back. But what will happen now, because of the refraction, the ray will bend towards the normal, right? So if I zoom this, I will get a situation like this. Suppose ray is coming like this. This is the normal to the water air interface. So light will just bend towards a normal like this. Okay. And this is the path for the normal, this thing. This is the path for the, this is the path where it hits the mirror normally. Okay. Now it will hit like this. Okay. So for the mirror, the object is, object appears to be somewhere there at the top beyond C. Okay. Then only light will, appear to bend towards a normal. So the image is slightly away from the C. Okay. So that is why when image is slightly away from C, the object will come closer to the, as in between O and C it will go. Right, so it will be a real image located between point C and O. All right, so this actually will be solved best if you are able to analyze the ray diagram. Okay, because there is no definitive statement over here. You just have to just evaluate the options. Okay. All of you clear about this? Any doubt? Type in yes or no. All right. See, anyways, this is getting recorded. So you can always refer this any moment. So what is the answer for 18th? Again, it is an theoretical question, right? It's a theoretical one. All right, should we solve now? Fine, question number 18. First of all, yellow light will be like of the order of 500 nanometers, right? And this is a wavelength of yellow light. And wavelength of X-ray is like, I think 1 to 100 angstrom. Okay, or whatever it may be, you know that the wavelength of X-ray is very, very less than the wavelength of yellow light. Or frequency of X-ray is very high compared to the frequency of yellow light. Okay, now in the single slit experiment, or in fact in the double slit experiment also, both of the cases, the assumption is that the size of slit is comparable to the wavelength. Okay, now if you use X-ray, the wavelength is so less that for X-ray, it is not a small hole. It's not a small hole where you can say that it's a single slit experiment, right? It's not a narrow opening. For X-ray, it is like, you know, a huge opening. So there will be no fringes that will be observed. So that is why option number 4 is correct over here. Okay, because light will bend from the edges, or diffraction will happen only when wavelength is comparable to the size of the hole. Okay, now do the 19th one. 19th, what do you think is the answer? Okay, now this is a thin slice of the cylinder. Thin slice that cut out of the cylinder. So this cylinder actually, it's a part of cylinder that comes out of your screen. Okay, so when you look at this ray, okay, and if you look at all the rays, suppose are hitting along the line, which line is coming out of your screen, then all of these line will be similar, right? They will encounter same amount of path difference. They will have an refraction over here, like this. It will go and then it will simply bend away from the normal, and then reflection will happen. So all the lights which are in this line, the line which comes out of your screen, will encounter this scenario. Fine. So there is a line symmetry over here. Fine. So there is a line symmetry. It is not a circular symmetry. So that is why it will be straight. The fringes will be straight. Okay. So these are, I think, these are not numerical. So you just have to know actually some concepts to solve these theoretical ones. But it is very easy to go wrong in these theoretical questions, because you can think in any direction. So it becomes tricky at times. Whereas numerical, you'll get a definitive answer. Oh, you're saying option D, fringe spacing increases as we go outwards. See, outwards means you are coming out of the screen, okay? If it is straight, then there is no question of spacing when you are coming out of the screen, because along the same screen, same along the one straight line, there is only one fringe. Okay, in last option it was not clearly written whether it is a straight or a circular fringe they are talking about when they talk about spacing. Okay, good that you have answered the second one initially. In a compound microscope, the intermediate image, we know intermediate image is inverted, real, and magnified. So this is just knowledge-based question. If you have studied your NCERT properly, then you'll get it immediately. Question number 20. Are you able to read it properly? Because the font size became very less. Or should I upload it again? So 20th question is on the lens maker formula. So we have this formula, 1 by F is equal to mu 2 by mu 1 minus 1 multiplied by 1 by R1 minus 1 by R2. Right? Shreyas, okay, fine. Legible. Now it is fine. Anyways, it's fine. So we have a concave lens which has refractive index 1.5. So basically, mu 2 is refractive index of the material, which is 1.5. Okay. So same radius of curvatures were there, right, in the concave lens. So it was like this. This is the concave lens, right? So basically, for this radius of curvature, if you take minus r, and for that side, you have to take it as plus r. Okay, so r1 is minus r and r2 is plus r. Okay, so when you immerse in a medium of refractive index 1.75, then what will happen? Let's say 1.75 minus 1. 1 divided by minus r minus of 1 divided by r. Okay, so this will become equal to 1.5 minus 1.75 to minus 2 by r. Okay, so this is 1 by f. Fine. So you are getting focal length as positive. So F is greater than zero. So focal length is positive means what? It means that when parallel rays come and hit this lens, it will get converged forward. Then only you'll say that focal length is positive, right? So it becomes a converging lens. Okay. So concave usually is diverging, but when the medium's refractive index becomes more than the material's refractive index, the same diverging lens becomes, or it will act as a converging lens. Okay, so it becomes a convergent lens. So option 3 and 4, they are out of question. Okay, all of you have answered third for this. Focal length is 1.75 divided by 0.25 into r divided by 2. Okay, so this is this is 4 into 0.875 times r, which is 3.5 times r. Okay, so question 20, option 1 is correct. How do you know r1 is minus r? See, r is geometrical property. It is a concave lens, right? So this side should be like this. Okay. So center of curvature will be on the left hand side. Okay. So if center of curvature on the left hand side, you're measuring distance from here, you're moving against the incident ray, right? So for concave surface, radius center of curvature is this side, right? So that is the reason why radius of curvature of this side is negative. We are using sine convention. All right.